with the syllabus structure. Here we have to here we have to start with Maxwell's equation. In our as per our previous knowledge of subject, we are knowing Ampere's law, we are knowing Faraday's law, we are knowing Gauss law and similar laws that we are defining electromagnetic fields can be studied or analyzed by we all here. For example, in case of Maxwell's equation, Maxwell was one of the scientists who have worked a lot on the electromagnetic field and provided us four equations so as to understand behavior of electromagnetic waves in different media. So it is not possible to continue Maxwell's equations directly. For that purpose, we have to start with a short revision of basics of vector calculus, basic laws of electromagnetics, Maxwell's equation, and boundary conditions at the media interface. So all these topics can be considered to be basic of studying or learning electromagnetic waves that we have to continue here. And I think all the students are knowing vectors, but as a part of you can consider it as a part of revision or the necessity of the subject. So let us start with the first slide. So here is the basics of vector. Now we have to understand that if suppose a point is there, for example, I have considered coordinates. Definitely the coordinates are in Cartesian coordinate systems, in which if suppose there is a point A having coordinates 5, minus 6, 3 and B, minus 1, 4, 7, any general coordinate that can be considered. Then here we can observe that if we have to calculate vector AB, we know that for calculation of vector AB, we have to consider B bar minus A bar. That is all the coordinates of B minus all the coordinates of A will be giving us the vector AB bar. As due to the mathematical aspect here, it was not possible today to add bar line on this AB, but I think each and every student of the class can understand that it is AB bar because it is a vector. Also, all the students may be having clear idea regarding scalars and vectors. So what are scalars? The physical quantities which are having only magnitude can be considered as a scalar. And the physical quantities which are having magnitude along with its direction can be considered as a vector. Let us consider a general example. If suppose I have to tell you my weight, if suppose I will say that my weight is suppose 70 kg or 70 kilogram, how I can say? I will just say my weight is 70 kg. It is not necessary or required to tell that my weight is 70 kg in this specific direction like that. Therefore, scalars can be the quantities for which only magnitude is the essential parameter required. Instead of that, if suppose I am going at a particular place and I had to explain my speed or velocity of my vehicle, then if suppose I had to write it or I had to express, I will say that the speed or the velocity of my vehicle is 40 kilometer per hour in this specific direction. It will be complete information regarding my velocity or speed. Is it clear? Therefore, vectors are the quantities which are having requirement of magnitude as well as a direction. So a general example I had given here, a mass can be considered or a weight can be considered as a scalar one, and velocity or speed can be considered to be a vector quantity. So if suppose we have to calculate vector AB bar, as shown here, I will consider minus 1 minus 5 into I, where I J and K are the unit vectors in the direction of x-axis, y-axis and z-axis. I think each and every student of the class is able to imagine the coordinate system in Cartesian coordinate system, and everyone is able to imagine the unit vectors along x-axis, y-axis and z-axis. One more basic example for this unit vectors can be described with a simple example. If suppose I'm going to a market and I had to purchase onion over there, if suppose I will ask what is the rate of onions per kg, etc., but the shopkeeper is saying that it is 100 rupees per 2.5 kilogram. And if suppose I have to bring 7 kilograms of onions to my home, what I will have to do? Though the shopkeeper is selling it 2.5 kilograms for 100 rupees, what will be the basic requirement? I will have to calculate the rate of onion per 1 kilogram. That is for different calculations in our mathematical aspect or different engineering subject. We need unit quantities to be described so as to analyze or study these concepts effectively. Therefore, I will have to divide 100 by 2.5. It will be giving out a value of 40 rupees. Then I will have to consider that for 7 kilograms of that required onion or similar quantity, I will have to spend 7 multiplied by 40, that is 280 rupees. I will have to check whether 280 rupees are there in my wallet, then only I can continue with the routine. That is, to complete any specific job, we'll have to consider unit quantities to be described effectively. Then only it will be possible that we can analyze these concepts in a more effective manner. In the same way, here in case of any coordinate system, why I am saying any? Because we have to consider Cartesian coordinate system. Again, we have to consider with the cylindrical coordinate system. And again, we will have to understand the spherical coordinate system. For these aspects, we have to start with the basic. Here in the vector theory, we have to consider whether the point is in Cartesian coordinate system or whether the vector is assumed in cylindrical coordinate system or it is in the spherical coordinate system. That can be the main starting of the subject. For that purpose, I will have to consider these parameters effectively. And also from the basic knowledge here, what we were studying here, IJK. Okay, so unit vector in case in the direction of x-axis, if suppose there is one unit, whether it is 1 centimeter, 1 millimeter, 1 meter, or also let us consider 1 micrometer, we can consider that the distance can be considered to be a multiple of the unit value. Therefore, in x-axis direction, we have defined one unit vector that is denoted here by I. In the similar way, there is another vector in the direction of y-axis or positive y-axis, we can say, that is nothing but J. And in the positive z-axis, we can consider a unit vector K. For any vector in the universe, if it is to be expressed in Cartesian coordinate system, we can describe it as the terms of I, J and K. Also, this can be analogous to our mark sheet. Whenever you will be going for an interview, they will be asking you, show me your mark sheet. And the interviewer will be finding the marks of the student, what is the progress of the student in a numerical type of subject, what are the capabilities of the students in core subject, what is the eligibility or what is the strength of the students in a mathematical subject, what is the logical abilities of the subject of the students. All these parameters can be made clear by the knowledge of marks in specific subject. In the similar way, here to express any vector, we have to consider AB will be equal to something into I, that is X component, something into J, that is Y component, and something into K, that is Z component. Here, as I think each and every student have completed the calculation, minus 1, minus 5 is minus 6i, 4 minus minus 6 is plus 10j, and 7 minus 3 is 4k. Also, you might have seen a bar will be equal to minus ab bar. Therefore, if suppose we have to calculate the vector in the reverse direction or in the opposite direction, ba bar, what is the necessity? We'll have to consider final point is to be considered as A and initial point will be B. Therefore, the vector can be expressed as 6i minus 10j minus 4k. If there is any mathematical confusion, you can post or you can ask me at any time. So let us proceed further. In our previous lecture, we had seen that there are three different coordinate systems that we have to consider. One is Cartesian coordinate system, one is cylindrical coordinate system, and third is the spherical coordinate system. Now, we have to consider, you suppose I, J, K are the vectors or unit vectors in x-axis, y-axis, and z-axis, then we have to remember from today that if suppose there is 3ax bar plus 4ay bar plus 5az bar, we will say that the vector is considered in Cartesian coordinate system. Instead of that, if suppose cylindrical coordinate system is there, we will have to consider that ar bar will be the unit vector in r direction or radius direction or radial direction, that we can say phi is the curved direction, that is nothing but the direction of the angle made by the imaginary plane, and az bar will be the component in positive z axis, that can be shown here as per the arrow is indicating. Therefore, if suppose we are observing a point with specification like 3 AR bar plus 4 AFI bar plus 5 AZ bar, we will say that this is a point in a cylindrical coordinate system. In a similar way, if suppose spherical coordinate system is there, AR bar will be the unit vector in the radius of sphere, A theta bar will be the direction of the angle made by the cone here, and lastly A phi bar will be the angle made by or the direction A phi bar will be the angle or the direction of unit vector in the direction of angle phi, that is the angle made by an imaginary plane with positive x-axis. So here we have to consider three coordinate system, and it will not be possible for every time for book authors as well as we people also to express at each and every time that this is a point in a cylindrical coordinate system, this is a point in spherical coordinate system. Instead of that, we have denoted our symbols or Cartesian coordinate system unit vectors, cylindrical coordinate system unit vectors, and spherical coordinate system unit vectors. In the similar way, if suppose for the previous example, if suppose we'll repeat once again, the same example can be completed like this. All the values are same. There is no any. I have just copied and pasted the same slide. Just I have changed I that was nothing but the unit vector in the direction of x-axis as ax bar. The unit vector j in the direction of y-axis is changed by ay bar, and the unit vector in the direction of az bar that was denoted by k in previous slide, it is renamed as az bar. The red colored equation indicates that this is a vector in Cartesian coordinate system. If it was expressed as minus 6 ar bar plus 10 a phi bar plus 4 az bar, we could say it is a point in cylindrical coordinate system. In a similar way, if suppose it is expressed as minus 6 ar bar plus 10 a theta bar plus 4 a phi bar, then we could say it is a vector in a spherical coordinate system. So as per the previous knowledge, we had seen that ba bar is equal to minus ab bar. That also can be considered with this simpler mathematics, that can be considered with the final point minus initial point. In case of ab, b is a final point and a is initial point. For consideration of this vector, we will have to write final point minus initial point. Therefore, here for the case of ba bar, we can consider a as the final point and b as the initial point. So why final minus initial is to be done? A general example can be given that if suppose Amar is driving a vehicle and he have to calculate what is the total distance from point A to point B, any two points he is going to consider, and he is driving his two wheeler, and instead of taking any meter scale, he will be using the speedometer of the vehicle. What Amar will do? Amar will count. Amar will note down the count of starting point and the count on the ending point. If suppose at point A, Amar is moving. If suppose reading is 100, and wherever Amar is going to stop, our final point, if suppose it is 30, then what? If total distance is 30, and the speedometer reading is 130, what Amar will do to calculate the distance? Amar will not make 100 minus 130. It will be a negative value. What Amar will have to do? Amar will have to consider final coordinate minus initial coordinate. Therefore, he will take a pen and paper. He will write 130 minus 100. It will be nothing but 30 kilometer is the distance between the two points A and B. A general example that we can consider. So next is, I think this point is clear to each and everyone. So now this can be considered to be the first two important derivation of our syllabus. Instead of considering only our first or introductory chapter, here are the two major theorems that we have to study or we have to understand. Then only we can start with the understanding of Maxwell's equation. So it will be a part of exercise to all the students that you have to remember these equations, and a statement of these equation can also be expressed to be possible by you. For example, here we will consider that F bar is any vector. If suppose F is suppose force, then here S is indicating that it is a surface integral. What is surface integral? We are knowing that for surface calculation or surface area, we'll have to consider double integration. In the similar way, if suppose there is a volume, we will have to consider triple integration. Therefore, what is the statement of this divergence theorem? Statement of divergence theorem is that if there is a vector and a surface integral is to be converted into volume integral, we can take the divergence of the given vector and we can replace the surface integral by volume integral. Once again, I will repeat. Surface integral can be converted into volume integral by taking the divergence of given vector. Now, next question is, what is nothing but divergence? Divergence, friends, here divergence can be defined as if suppose there is a vector pi plus qj plus rk, if we'll find the derivative of this p with respect to x, it will be px. If we'll find the derivative of q part with respect to y, it will be qy. And the derivative of r component with respect to z can be considered to be rz. And this quantity will be reflected here in case of triple integration. For numerical calculation, we need to convert a surface integral into volume integral as well as volume integral into surface integral. For that purpose, we have to remember these two laws. In the same way, I think Stokes' theorem can be made clear to each and everyone. That is, if suppose there is any vector f, and it is a single integral. If suppose we have to convert that line integral into surface integral, what we can do? We can write that line integral can be converted into surface integral by taking the curl of given vector. Now question arises, what is the curl? Friends, curl is nothing but the determinant of vector is considered, in which first row will be consisting of suppose ax bar, ay bar and az bar unit vectors. Second row of the determinant will be partial derivatives, that is dou by dou x, dou by dou y and dou by dou z. And third row will be consisting of the components of a bar. Briefly, as this is last slide of our today's introductory lecture of divergence theorem and Stokes' theorem, just remember, or if suppose it is convenient to understand Stokes' theorem first and divergence theorem, that also can be done. I will repeat the equation once again, or I would like to express it in a statement form. I will say that Stokes' theorem can be defined as the line integral can be converted into surface integral by taking the curl of given vector considered. In the same way, surface integral can be converted into volume integral by consideration of divergence of the given vector. Both the quantities of divergence theorem and Stokes' theorem are very much essential for conversion of any vector or integral from surface to volume or from line to surface. Remember this slide because it will be essential for calculation of a number of example in next few lectures. So let us stop here. I think second lecture also is to be continued. So if there are any questions, confusions, doubts that we can discuss in next lecture, keep them ready. Or if there is nothing to be having any issues, you can practice these equations. So let us stop here. If there are no any queries, we'll continue in the next lecture. Thank you. Wish you a happy day.